Very good morning, all of you. I am Dr. M.C. Natraja, professor from the Department of Civil Engineering, Ramaya Institute of Technology, MSRIT, Bangalore. I welcome all my students to the session 5 under the module 5. So this is in connection with the subject, design of steel structural elements for the 6th semester students under VTU. Students, as I mentioned in the previous class, today I will be discussing about the problems connected with laterally unsupported beam, and also I told you as to what this laterally supported and unsupported beams are in the previous class. We have seen the behavior, we have seen the various factors that will have an influence on the behavior, and also the various provisions that are there in IS 800 also has been explored. And we have seen the different formulas and where exactly the formulas are available and when to use those formula depending on the situation. Today we will be able to explore all those formula depending on the type of the problem. So let us take one simple problem. So this is problem number one. This is a simply supported beam, and of course this is provided for a warehouse building where we have a series of beams kept at some spacing, and the warehouse itself is having some internal dimension. So the roofing system is such that it carries a live load of 5 kN per meter square, and along with the floor finish of 1.25 kN per meter square. The floor is having a thickness of 125 mm, and the whole slab with the I section is being supported on a wall having a thickness of 600 mm. So I try to understand what is this problem. This is a practical problem of a warehouse building. So kindly see how the building looks like first. So this is what the configuration of the warehouse, where we have a series of I-beams kept at a spacing of 3.5 meters center to center. So this is what the beam is. 1, 2, 3. So these are the three beams, so which will undergo bending in a laterally supported manner. And also we have the support at the end. Kindly see, all round we have the wall and hoop thickness is also specified. And kindly see the cross section. If you cut the warehouse in the longitudinal direction, where you cut an individual beam, so then the configuration looks something like this. We have an independent I section acting as a beam, and we have the floor whose thickness is 125 mm, which acts as a slab. The entire load of the slab is transferred to the beam, and what component of the dead load and live load gets transferred? So that's what the question we need to ask. In addition to the dead load, we also have the live load and the finish load. So this is what the problem is. So the length of the warehouse is 14 meter, and the internal dimension is 7.2. so out of this dimension, 7.2 meter by 14 meter, so obviously 7.2 meter happens to be the internal span. So this is where the clear span of the beam comes into picture, and since it is supported on a wall of thickness 600 mm, we need to identify what is the bearing on each of the wall, each of the support. So knowing the bearing, we'll be able to calculate the effective span, and then we'll be able to identify what is the total UDL that is coming on one I section as a beam. So from that consideration, so we need to determine the bending moment, shear force, and of course the whole process of analysis and design goes. The spacing of the beams, as you can see here, it is 3.5 meter center to center. Let us take one intermediate beam from the point of analysis of the load. So it is the same warehouse, as you can see here. I have taken one intermediate beam. Kindly see the intermediate beam. So if you see from the side, the beam is supported on a span 7.8 meter. So what is this effective span? So it is the clear span plus the bearing. So the clear span is 7.2, and kindly see the thickness of the wall is 600 mm. So that is also given in the problem. So this 600 mm appears to be onto the higher side, but generally the wall thickness is around 250 mm, 300 mm, 400 mm depending on the situation. So since it is a warehouse, obviously the size of the wall is rather more. So that is where the heaviness of the wall comes into picture, and that is the reason. So the thickness of the wall being the bearing is 600 mm. Otherwise, if it is any other type of an industrial building, so probably the wall thickness would have been 300 to 400 mm. Now, if you see the final configuration, so it is something like this. Over an effective span, the beam bends like this. So that's where we have the deflected profile. We also have the bending moment and its variation, shear force and its variation along the span of 7.8 meter. Now, what is the load that is coming on one of the intermediate beam? So that is where taking 50% of the spacing on either side comes into picture. So whatever the spacing we have to the left and the spacing to the right, so 50% contribution of the load from each of the adjacent spacing comes into picture. In other words, as far as this intermediate beam is concerned, equal to one spacing, where spacing by two and spacing by two on either side is what the contribution as per the calculation of the load is concerned. Now kindly see the imposed load. So the imposed load is in the form of a live load, 5 kN per meter square. Obviously it is a surface load, area load. And also see the floor finish, 1.25 kN per meter square. In some situation, the floor finish will not be given, then you have to assume the floor finish suitably. About 1 kN per meter square is good enough, and if it is given, so that value should be taken as it is. So there are two imposed load coming into picture. One is the live load, 5, another is the finish load. If you add, it is 6.25 kN per meter square of live load comes into picture. And also you have the dead load, and all the loads in the form of a UDL need to be considered as far as the beam is concerned. So that is where converting this surface load into live load comes into picture. So let us see how that can be done. So this is what the imposed load acting on the beam. So that need to be multiplied with the spacing so that an equivalent value of the UDL you will be able to get on the beam. So with this, calculation of load comes into picture. So the clear span of the beam, 7.2 meter. Effective span, clear span plus bearing. So bearing on either side, of the bearing to left support, of the bearing to right support. So that the total bearing of 600 mm comes into picture being 0.6 meter. So totally 7.8 meter is what the effective span. So what is the self weight of the slab? So the thickness of the slab is 125 mm. 0.125 is what the thickness in meter. So acting over an area of 1 meter by 1 meter. So into the density of the concrete. So it is 24 kN per meter cube or 25 kN per meter cube depending on the grade of the concrete. And of course depending on the amount of reinforcement provided in the slab. But here onto the higher side, 25 is being assumed. 0.125 into 25. Of course, you have 1 into 1, taking 1 meter square of area. So that is where the load is kilonewton per meter square, similar to the other imposed loads. So that will come to 1.125 kilonewton per meter square. So to this, we need to add the floor finish load and also the live load. So live load being the imposed load. So taking all these loads, if you add it, so it will be the total imposed load on the roof for one particular beam. So that is 9.375 kilonewton per meter square. So this is what the load that is needed if you are designing a slab. But we need to design the steel beam. Obviously this load need to be converted as the line load or the UDL as kilonewton per meter. To do that, so we need to multiply this area load as a line load. For that, the spacing 3.5 meter comes into picture. So 9.375 into spacing is 32.8 kilonewton per meter. Assuming the self weight of the beam, so what is that we have done is, so we have taken the live load and we have taken the finishing load, and also we have taken the dead load of the slab, and that is what the total load that is coming on the beam as a UDL. But the beam what you are going to select later also will be having some weight. So initially, depending on the type of the building and depending on what might be the final beam you are going to select, so it will be approximately assuming certain weight as the self weight of the beam. So that also need to be considered, and that is generally assumed as 1 kilonewton per meter. So if you take 1 meter length of any standard I-beam of medium depth, it weighs about 100 kg. So one person can easily lift the beam of length 1 meter. So obviously that 100 kg is something like 1 kilonewton per running meter. So that per running meter is straight away added to this total load, calculated based on the finished load, live load and the self weight. Then it becomes 33.81 kilonewton per meter. So you can take this as 33.81 only, or this can be rounded off to 34, and here I have rounded off slightly onto the higher side, 35 kilonewton per meter. So kindly see that this 35 kilonewton per meter is what the working load, but we will be doing the analysis in design based on the ultimate condition. So that is where the limit state of collapse comes into picture. So we need to increase this load by an appropriate factor of safety applied partially onto the load. So that is where multiplying 35 kilonewton per meter with partial safety factor for the load, for the combination of dead load and live load, comes into picture. In fact, this we have seen in the module 1, and that partial safety factor is 1.5. Excuse me, just a minute. Yeah, sorry for the disturbance. So the total factor load with this working load is 52.5 kilonewton per meter. So 1.5 into 35. So this is what the ultimate load, and based on this we need to calculate the two structural parameters from the point of design. So that is where the design bending moment M comes into picture, and the design shear force. What is this design bending moment? So the design bending moment, as you know, the formula is WL² / 8. So here it is designed as a simply supported element but subjected to the ultimate load W. W is 52.5 kilonewton per meter, and substituting that value here, the span being 7.8 square, so we have the answer 399.26, so very close to 400 kilonewton meter. So why I am rounding off all these values is to appreciate the value of the structural parameters. Of course, in the design, we can still take it as 339.26, but this is very close to 400, because so this is what the ultimate moment that need to be considered in the analysis and design. Now, what is the design shear force based on the ultimate load or the factored load? So the formula is WL/2. So 52.5 into 7.8/2, so that is equal to 204.75 kilonewton. Friends, so we have calculated the loads. The given surface load has been converted into live load, line load, and with that we have determined the design bending moment and the design shear force. So for the design bending moment, we need to select the section, and then we need to check the section from the point of shear force. So this is what the two things as a part of further design. Let us see how this 400 kilonewton meter can be considered from the point of selection of the section. In fact, this is what the formula we have seen in IS 800. So the value of the design moment M is equal to plastic section modulus into Fy upon gamma MO. So from that formula, the plastic section modulus with respect to the horizontal axis, so that is where the major principal axis of the beam comes into picture. So you can calculate that value. So that is nothing but the moment 400 kilonewton meter. So into 10 to the power of 6. So converting the kilonewton to newton and meter to mm. So 1000 into 1000, and that is equal to 10 to the power of 6. So divided by 250 upon 1.1. So 250 is the characteristic yield strength of the steel. Dividing that by 1.1, so we are going to get the design strength. So this is what the moment for which you need to design, and that divided by the design strength, so we are going to get the section modulus. So what is the section modulus? So this is what the section modulus corresponding to the complete plastification. So that is where this is also called as plastic section modulus of the section, and for this modulus we need to select the I section. Now kindly see the I section. What you are going to select will be something like this. So we have the designation where certain depth of the I section need to be selected from the steel table, where we have the properties of the different sections of the steel sections available. You can also refer to IS 800. We have an annex in that all the details of I section is made available. We can also look into SP61. So that is a special publication where different rolled sections and their properties are given, and you also have a separate code IS 808 exclusively for the properties of these beam sections. But generally the students will be referring to steel table, and in the first class I suggested that students need to purchase one steel book also. In fact, we have steel table written by Agor, seems to be the good textbook from the point of steel design. And even the soft copy of many of these tables is available in the Google also, so you can download depending on the situation. So what is the depth of the section you are going to select? And once that depth is identified, so based on the information available in the steel table, all other properties, the width of the flange, thickness of the flange, thickness of the web, radius of the root at the junction, and also the D which is required for check for buckling, and also the rest of the distance. So that is where the thickness of the flange and the radius at the root, the combined thickness also comes into picture when you want to check for the crippling. So that is where the crippling or the crimping of the junction comes into picture. So this is where the web crippling concept, which I explained in one of the earlier classes, also can be looked at. So let us see how the section can be selected with this 1.76 into 10 to the power of 6 mm cube of plastic section modulus. So I have selected the section ISMB 500, which is having a weight of 869 kilonewton per meter. So 86.9 kg per meter. So in fact, if you remember, the load what we have assumed as a self weight is approximately, it is how much is that? Kindly say here, if you go back, so we have taken the self weight as 1 kilonewton per meter. Kindly say here, so this is where 869, sorry, this is not kilonewton, so there is a small mistake. So this is actually newton per meter. So 869 newton per meter, and that is approximately 86.9 kg. So this is where the skill comes into picture. So 1 meter beam, probably you can lift it with both of your hands. Now with this ISMB 500 selected for the plastic section modulus, what are the other dimensions of the section? So width of the flange, so you can see here it is 180 mm. The overall depth, sometimes it is referred to as capital D, otherwise it is H, as you can make out here. And thickness of the flange is always be more compared to thickness of the web. So out of the two, web is always be thinner. So this is where 17.2 mm, and thickness of the web 10.2 mm comes into picture. So it is a thinner element. So the radius at the root of the junction here, we also have another radius, as you can see here, it is the radius at the toe. So this is the projection of the flange. So this is anyway looks like a toe, so the radius, and that value here it is the radius of the root, so that is where R1 comes into picture. So this also we need to get it from the steel table, but this information of R1 is not available in IS 800. So IS 800 will help in selection of the section, and many of these information you do get from that, but the radius at the root you have to refer to the steel table from any of the standard textbooks on steel table, or the relevant IS code needs to be looked at. And also I told you, especially from the point of checking for the buckling, so we need this depth over the fillet. So that is where from the overall height we need to subtract the thickness of the flange and the radius at the junction. So to one side we have that combined thickness, and similarly onto the other side also we have, so that h minus of that combined thickness, both at top and bottom, if you do it, we are getting d. So that d is h minus of 2 times of thickness of the flange plus the radius at the junction. So that is 500 mm. As you can see here, the overall depth minus 2 into 17.2 plus 17. So 17.2 is what the thickness of the flange, and the radius of the junction 17. So 431.6 mm is the answer. So please remember, this 431, which is calculated based on h, in this case it is 500. So this is required in the section classification. So 431 is needed to classify the web to check whether it is plastic or compact, and depending on that only the value of beta need to be identified. And also for the section classification, my dear friends, we need the projection of the flange also. So that is where the projection of the flange from the center comes into picture. So BF by 2, if you do like that, so that is where the projection, dividing that by the thickness of the flange. So in case of a tapered section, so at the length, which is half the length of the projection, if you calculate, even though it is tapered, so that is where the average thickness of the flange comes into picture. So based on that, so you'll be able to make the classification. So what is the type of the flange? Is it plastic or compact? So if this is plastic, and also web is plastic, the section as a whole is plastic. By chance the flange is plastic because the thickness is more, the projection is also less, there is a very possibility that this can be plastic, but web may be compact. So in that situation, whole cross section is assumed to be compact. Plastic hinge is likely to come in plastic analysis, but the rotation of the section may not happen because it is not a plastic section. So from the steel table, as far as this ISMB 500 at the rate of 869 Newton per meter, so it is 2074 into 0.67 into 10 to the power of 3 mm cube. So directly with reference to ZPZ, so we can select the section. I will show you all these values in the next slide. And also we need the elastic section modulus. So the elastic section modulus ZE with respect to the horizontal ZZ axis is 1810 into 10 to the power of 3. So this is needed to calculate the moment capacity. And the second one is needed from the point of check, where the moment should be less than 1.2 times of the elastic section modulus into the yield stress upon the partial safety factor. So the two formula we have discussed just in the previous class, where ZP for the plastic capacity of the section, that is where the design moment MD comes into picture, and for checking as a simply supported beam, so elastic section modulus is required. And also we need the moment of inertia of the entire I section with respect to the major axis. So major axis is nothing but the major principal axis, which is the symmetric axis which divides the section into two parts. So this is 45,200 into 10 to the power of 4 mm to the power of 4. So this section, this modulus is really not needed in the design, but in the design for the deflection, where the actual deflection should be less than the allowable deflection, so we need this second moment of area. So from this the deflection need to be worked out. So even this information is not available in IS-800, in that annex where you are getting the properties of the I section. So for this also we need to refer to steel table. So some of the properties we get it from the steel table or from the respective IS codes, and some information to facilitate the design. So important parameters you get it from IS-800 as well. Now let us see how to select the properties. So probably by this time student must have seen the steel table, because in the initial chapters the design of member subjected to tension and compression, so you must have already seen the various classes of IS-800. But there is one annex H where the plastic properties of the beam is given. So kindly say these are all the beam section. So IS-WB-600, so this is what the maximum depth of the I section under the rolled category. So ISMB, ISWB, ISLB, ISMB 550, ISWB, like that. So we have the sections in the decreasing order of their depth comes into picture. But here if you see, there is a star. What is this? So under the depth of 600 ISWB, so we have one category of a beam where the weight per running meter is slightly onto the higher side, whereas the second one is somewhat lighter. So 145 kg per meter. So kindly say, this is where kg per meter comes into picture, but in some of the codes, so this weight is calculated as Newton per meter. So here it is 133.7 kg per meter. So there is about 12 kg reduction in the weight from the first category to second category, even though the depth of the beam is same. Sometimes the depth is same and sometimes the width is also same, but what is important is the thickness of the flange and the web will be different. So let us have a small look at those things also. So 600 and 600 being the depth. So kindly see here, 250 is what the width in both the cases. And now when you come here, so it is 23.6 mm thickness of the flange, but here it is 21.1 mm. So somewhat lesser thickness of the flange in the second category for the same depth, but here the thickness of the web is 11.8 in the first case, but in the second case it is 11.2. So obviously with this small reduction in the thickness of the flange and the web, the element is becoming somewhat slender. So that is what you need to check, and there is every possibility that the second section may be compact in some cases. But if you see the first section is generally going to be plastic in nature, and even the second section also may be plastic, but we need to check it. But if at all there is any change in the behavior, so the first one might be plastic, the second one might be compact, and you need to check it to see whether that is really so. Because there is a reduction in the thickness, so kindly see that there is a reduction in the area also. 184.86 is what the area in centimeter square as per the first section is concerned. The second section is slightly having a lesser area. So this is where some 10 to 15% reduction in area comes into picture, and that is what is reflected in this reduced weight of the second section. Now what is that we really need to do? So we need to select the section for the plastic section modulus which you have calculated. So kindly see this plastic section modulus, 1.73 into 10 to the power of 6. So kindly represent these values in terms of what is that value in terms of 10 to the power of 3, so that whatever the value you have here, so that will be the value for which straight away without any confusion we'll be able to select the section. So this is 1760 approximately, 1760 into 10 to the power of 3 is what the answer as far as plastic section modulus is concerned. Now I have selected ISMB 500. So what is that? Kindly say this is what the initial portion of the table, and there are many more properties onto the other side, so that we'll be seeing in the second slide. So this is where ISMB 500 comes into picture. So kindly say this is the thickness of the flange, width of the flange thickness of the web 10.2. So this is what I have written. And kindly see the radii of gyration. So radii of gyration with respect to two axes. One is the major axis and with respect to the minor axis. This is not needed for the design of beam. So this is needed in case of the compression design. The member as a compression member. So we need these values to calculate the slenderness ratio. So this is what the section modulus 1808 centimeter cube, but this is under the elastic condition. But kindly see this one, 2074 into 0.67. So roughly 2074 into 10 to the power of 3, which is written here, is the plastic section modulus. So this higher value and this elastic section modulus being a lower value, if you divide one by the other, it is 1.147. So this is what the shape factor of the section. So in fact, we have discussed about the shape factor also. And also I mentioned you need to take one or two sections from the steel table, knowing all the values of the elements. So work out as to what the plastic section modulus and the elastic section modulus, and then you can calculate the shape factor. So this is also one of the exercise students can try, because you know the answer, and whether your approach is correct or not can also be checked, and ultimately we need to end up with this answer. So 2074 is what the plastic section modulus as far as the section ISMB is concerned, but we need 2074. So that is where 2074 is what the thing. And also I want to tell you about IS 808. So this is another code mentioned in IS 800. So you can look to this code, and then also you can select the section. And one particular page connected with ISMB, I have put it here also. Kindly say, this is what the information extracted from IS 808. So this code is freely available in the Google. So MB means, so it is a medium beam. Of course IS is there, Indian standard medium beam. So kindly come here. So this is where the radius at the junction inner root comes into picture, that is 17.0. so this is what the 17.0 we have used for calculating D1. So this is needed from the point of classification of this section also. So what is the classification here? So we need the factor epsilon, and that factor epsilon, as you know, it is under the root of 250 upon Fy. So the grade of steel is 250 MPa. So with this epsilon is 1. And now we need to calculate the outstand of the flange. Outstand of the flange divided by the thickness of the flange. So outstand of the flange is 180 by 2, 90. And that 90, if you divide by 17.2, so we are going to get 5.23. So this 5.23 is less than 9.4 epsilon. So this is where one table in IS 800 you must have seen. So this I have showed in the module 1 during my explanation with respect to plastic method of analysis. So we have plastic section, compact section, and semi-compact and slender. So as long as the ratio for the flange is less than 9.4 times epsilon, so it is really plastic. The limiting value is 9.4, but the value what I have got is 5. So when you compare these two, there is substantial difference. So the section is not just plastic, it is really really plastic, and you can even increase the outstand, or for a given outstand the thickness can also be reduced further. So these are all some of the things we need to look at, especially when you are fabricating an I section using different plates. Now coming to the classification of the web. So this is where you should be very careful. It is simply the depth divided by the thickness of the web. But what is the depth? It is not the overall depth. Overall depth is 500. That's where the designation ISMB 500. From that 500, so we have subtracted the combined thickness of the flange and the radius at the inner root. So with that we are getting 431. So please remember this 431 as far as the web classification is concerned. So dividing that by 10.2, we are getting 42.31. So that should be less than 84 epsilon, and that is equal to 84. So 42.31 compared to 84, it's almost off. So the web is not slender. In fact, is it really not that slender? Obviously, the question of web undergoing buckling doesn't come into picture, and even the flange also is quite stable. So hence the section is plastic, and if at all a plastic hinge is going to come at the section where moment is maximum, so there is every possibility that the portion undergo continuous deformation without failure. So the purpose of the plastic hinge and what plastic hinge has to do, if at all we need to design that beam by plastic theory, so that can also be ensured from this property. So this is where the design for the moment is over. So let us see the check for the shear strength. So in fact, this is the design for the shear. So the predominant action in the beam is moment. So for that predominant action, we have done the design. Now we are doing the design for the shear, and it is more of a check to see whether the required shear, what that comes from the load, can be applied on the section. So this is where the shear capacity of the section comes into picture. And in fact, we have calculated this ultimate shear force 204 in the very first step, and that shear force should be less than or equal to what is called as the design shear capacity of the web, because we have already selected the section ISMB 500. The web property is already known, so corresponding to that, and what is the maximum load that can be applied on the section. So that is very important. So that's where the design shear comes into picture. So the design shear is nothing but the nominal shear divided by the partial safety factor for the strength. So that is where 1.1 comes into picture. So this is nothing but H, overall depth of the section, and the thickness of the web. So what is this H into thickness of the web? So this is what the entire cross-sectional area of the web, right from top to bottom. So this is what is referred to as the area resisting the shear. So the entire depth of the beam is resisting the shear. So that is where the overall depth 500 comes into picture. 10.2 being the thickness of the web, and the yield stress being 250, and that need to be divided by under the root, because 250 by root 3 is what the shear that causes the yielding. So that is what the stress corresponding to shear yielding. If it is not a shear yielding, if it is a conventional yielding, then you would have put 250. So 250 is what the yield strength, either in tension or compression. But so this is where the yield stress in shear, 250 upon root 3. So gamma is 1.1. The whole answer I am dividing by 1000. So that straight away I can get the answer Vd as kilonewton. So kindly see that value 669.2. So that is substantially more than the reaction whatever we have calculated. So kindly see that also it is 204. So hardly 204 kilonewton as the shear is coming at the end as a reaction. But the web is so strong, the web can take about 669 kilonewton of shear. So means it is very, very safe. The amount of safety is almost 3 times. In fact, it is more than 3 times. So 669 divided by 204, if you do it, so definitely the selected section is more than 3 times safe compared to the shear actually coming at that section, which is because of the loads. So what is the type of the section because of this 669.2? So what is the 669? So if you calculate 60% of this, so that is what is going to cause the real yielding of the web. So 669.2 into 0.6, so that is where 401.52 kilonewton comes into picture, means about 401 kilonewton causes the shear yielding. Anything beyond that is a high shear case, but the actual shear what is coming is 204. So here the low shear value itself is 401, means till 401, so there is no yielding of the web happening. So only when the load exceeds 401, so there is a possibility that the web yields, and that part of the web may not be effective in resisting the moment. So but in this case, so 401 is substantially more than 204, because we are applying only 204, but the shear that is responsible for the situation to call it as a low shear is itself is 401. So the question of modifying the moment doesn't come into picture. So whatever the moment capacity we have determined, so kindly go to the moment carrying capacity. So what the moment carrying capacity, so we have considered as far as the section is concerned, so that is always the there, so that is not going to reduce. So that is the importance of the problem. Now kindly see here, so this is where the low shear case comes into picture. So we need to check the design from the moment capacity point of view. This is discussed in the class 8.2.11, so where M should be less than the MD. So what is MD? So this is where the shear capacity comes into picture. So D upon thickness of the web, so this is where the depth over the fillet comes into picture, 431. So this is what we have already calculated in the classification, so that is less than 67 epsilon. So kindly remember this 67 epsilon, so which I explained in one of the previous classes. If the ratio D by TW of the web exceeds 67 point epsilon, then the web is likely to undergo buckling. As a result of that, the web may not be able to attain plastification. So definitely, so this is not the case of high shear, nor it is the case where the web is likely to buckle. So definitely it is a stable element where it is undergoing yielding rather than failing by buckling. So with all these things, what is the moment carrying capacity of the section? MD, because of this low shear case. So beta B being 1, because the section is plastic, and we need to substitute the ZP. So that is where the actual plastic section modulus of the selected section comes into picture, into 250 upon gamma MO. That is where 1.1 into 10 to the power of 6. So 6 is not visible here properly. So the answer is 471. So even by taking the effect of the shear, because the shear is really not having any significant effect because it is a low value of the reaction. So MD with all these corrections is 471. But what the section has to resist from the point of actual bending moment is only 400 kilonewton meter. So the selected section is really, really safe. And also we have substantial factor of safety, 471 upon 400. So it is definitely about 20% in excess of the required capacity. If required, we can also look for some alternative sections, whether ISMB 450 is going to be sufficient, or maybe the other category under ISWB also can be checked. And finally, the one which is most appropriate and suiting to your requirement, and at the same time, the section which gives you some amount of economy also can be addressed. So this is where selection of different sections and then making a comparison and finally selecting the optimum section, which is not only economical, even best from the various points, from the point of remote states are concerned. So beta B is 1, so that is where the section is plastic, and that is what we have assumed, and the design is safe. So this is where the design for the limit state of collapse, the limit state of strength against moment and also against shear comes into picture. So both we have done, but now we need to do some secondary checks. So that is where the checking for the buckling, one for the vertical buckling, another for the crippling of the web, and finally check for the deflection. So these are the three additional checks, and with that the design is completed. So let us go to check for the maximum allowable deflection. So this is where the limit state of serviceability comes into picture. So my dear friends, So this is a very very simple calculation, but you should be very very careful. The moment and shear we have calculated for the ultimate condition. That is where the factored load comes into picture. So W, what we have substituted earlier is Wu. After calculating a load 35 kN per meter, that has been multiplied with 1.5. That is a limit state for the ultimate condition. But here it is a limit state under the serviceability condition. So the beam has to carry the load and it has to perform the intended function over the design period. So that is where the actual load, which is the allowable load, permissible load, or the elastic load, which is 35 kN per meter, comes into picture. So with this 35, we need to check. The formula, as you know, it is 5WL to the power of 4 divided by 384 EI, EI being the flexural rigidity. Now kindly see, as the moment of inertia of the section increases with respect to the major axis, so the deflection decreases. And if the deflection exceeds the limit, then you have to go for a higher section, the next higher section, where I is more. But what is this I here? It is the moment of inertia about the horizontal axis, ZZ axis, with respect to the major axis, being the major principal axis. Where are you going to get this IZ? So this IZ, you won't get it in IS 800, because the table only gives the plastic properties. We need to refer to the steel table to get this IZZ. In steel table, IZZ is represented as IXX. So in the earlier code, XX was the designation for the major axis, but in the current IS 800, horizontal axis is referred to as ZZ. So don't get confused, but we need to go by the magnitude of the value also when you are substituting. So this is the maximum value of the second moment of inertia compared to the value about the weaker axis, which is substantially less even when you are selecting. So kindly check these things and select the appropriate value, which is the correct value. So 5 upon 384 W L to the power 4 by EI. 5 into 35, because it is kilonewton per meter. In the numerator is kilonewton, in the denominator also it is kilonewton. So obviously into 1000, so 35 newton per mm, 35 kilonewton per meter. So there is a reason I am not changing this. 7.8 meter, it is 7800 mm, 780 centimeter, 7800 mm, raised to the power 4. So your numerator is such that it is in newton and in mm. See the denominator. So 384, what is this? 2 into 10 to the power of 5, the modulus of elasticity of steel. This is in newton per mm square. So that is where megapascal comes into picture. So there is also newton and mm square. What is I? So I is 4,5,200 into 10 to the power of 4. This is mm to the power 4. So when you are taking this value, you should be very careful. Check whether the value is in centimeter to the power of 4. If it is in centimeter to the power of 4, 10 to the power of 4 will not be available. So it is this value for which you are selecting. So 4,5,200 is what you are going to get in the steel table. So this is centimeter to the power 4. Mind you, you need to multiply that with 10 to the power of 4. With this substitution, so you are going to get the answer straight away as 9.335 in mm. Sometimes there will be confusion. What I suggest students is to substitute all these values. Calculate the value with your calculator. So ultimately you get some display. In that display, you need to select something in the range of one digit point something, or sometimes two digits point something. So this really cannot be 93.35 mm. So 93.35 mm is 9 centimeter. I don't think any beam will deflect to that extent. So as long as the values are close to 1 mm, 2 mm, 1 mm to 2 mm may be the correct answer, or at the most it may be even 10 or 11 or 12, something like that. But when you get a situation where the answer is something like 9 something or 8 something, it is generally going to be 8.3, 9.3, 7.8, something like that. If it is a very small value, it can be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 mm. And sometimes if the span is somewhat considerable, it can be even 10, 12, 13, 14, 18 mm, something like that. So all these things are really not needed to be discussed, but I need to take care of the slow learners. Sometimes the students are not having the required level of confidence. So while substituting, they really do some error. But when they calculate the answer is so messy, they'll simply write whatever the display they get it in the calculator. So to avoid that, so we have to be very careful to see what is the range of the deflection in terms of mm you are going to get. So if it is a small span, so close to 3, 4, 5, 6 mm, and if it is somewhat a long span, so close to 8 to 10, 12 mm of deflection we are going to get. Ultimately, that deflection is more or less compared to the allowable deflection also. So that is where allowable maximum deflection as a function of the span, it is L by 300. So this L by 300 also, you will be able to get it from the steel table. And in fact, we have seen one table in IS 800 where the allowable deflection, depending on the type of the building, depending on whether it is a cladded building or not, and also depending on what type of loading. So many such allowable deflection values you will be able to see. But simply remember L by 300 being the allowable value as far as these types of simple problems on beams are concerned. So 7800 upon 300, it is 26 mm. So 26 mm is what the maximum value, and beyond that, your beam is assumed to fail by way of serviceability limit state. So it reaches the limit of serviceability and thereby it fails. But the actual deflection is 9.35. It is far less compared to 26. The question of beam undergoing failure from the serviceability consideration with respect to deflection doesn't come into picture at all. So with this, so we have come to the end, but still we have two additional checks from the point of the behavior. So that is where the check from the web buckling point of view comes into picture and the web crippling point comes into picture. Now what is this check for the web buckling? So this is what the formula. Here it is a column buckling. So we need to calculate what is h by 2. So the overall depth is 500 and that by 2 is 500. And we need to calculate the non-dimensional slenderness ratio. So the non-dimensional slenderness ratio is given by KL by RY. So the simplification of this also we have seen, it is 2.45 D by TW. So the depth over the fillet is known, which you have calculated earlier, 431.6 into 2.45 by TW. If you do it, so we are going to get that value 102.6. So for this 102.6, so we need to select the actual stress in the web, where web is acting like a column. So and we need to select the stress referring to an appropriate table. So that is where referring to table C comes into picture, where we will be considering a certain imperfection introduced to the section from the point of fabrication. The stiff bearing width is taken as 100 mm. So with this 100 mm of stiff bearing width and the slenderness ratio being 102, so let us see what is the value of the stress. So going to the table 9C, so we have the value corresponding to the two values of the slenderness ratio. If we need to calculate the value of the stress based on the interpolation technique. So for 100, what is the value, and for 110, what is the value, and with that, so finally we are getting a value 104.50 newton per mm square after the interpolation. So this is what the stress in the web that causes the buckling. That should not happen. Then what is the load that really causes that? So that's what we are calculating here as the buckling load. 100 stiff bearing width plus of the depth 250 into thickness of the web, and of course the stress what we have calculated just now. So that if you convert as kilonewton, by dividing with 1000 or multiplying with 10 to the power of minus 3. So your answer is 373.07. In fact, for the beam to fail by buckling of the web, as a column buckling, 374 kilonewton is to be applied. But what is that we are really applying as a reaction? It is 204. So your section is definitely be able to carry 204 kilonewton and where there is no web failure. So that is the reason this is just a check. And also the possibility of the web undergoing such type of failure is very less in case of conventional rolled sections. And all these rolled sections are fabricated in such a way that their projection to the thickness or their depth to the thickness is made in such a way that there is no local buckling. Now kindly see the last check from the point of web crippling. So this is what the total crippling load, and for that so we have a formula. This has been derived earlier. So the stiff bearing width is 100, is not going to change, and this is what N2 is. So what is this N2? So corresponding to 1:2.5 times of the vertical depth, where that vertical depth is the thickness of the flange plus radius at the root fillet. So thickness of the flange and the radius at the root fillet, that multiplied by 2.5 times, because it is 1:2.5 dispersion from the edge of the bearing plate, and that is where 85.5 comes into picture. So kindly say that's what 85.5. So total width corresponding to the junction is this multiplied by the thickness of the web, so corresponding to that, and that is where the area, and that if you multiply with 250 being the yield stress and dividing that by 1.1. So to convert the characteristic value to the design value, this 1.1, again dividing the entire answer by 1000, so we have the kilonewton. So 430 kilonewton is what the load, so this beam is able to resist as a reaction, and corresponding to that, there is just a possibility of the junction undergoing crimpling. So that is where the real yielding and thereby some sort of a departure of the junction either to the left or to the right happens. That is where the flow of the material comes into picture. For that to happen, we need 430 kilonewton, but what we are applying is hardly 204, so there is no chance of the web buckling, web crippling or crimpling to happen in this present case. But as far as this is concerned, so this web crimpling is concerned, that is really not a issue. So provide ISMB 500 at the rate 869 newton mm. So I had made a mistake earlier, as kilonewton it is 86.9 kg or 869 newton per meter. So friends, with this we have checked the beam from the consideration of secondary effect. The primary effect is moment, for which you have designed by selecting an appropriate section based on the plastic section modulus, and later we have checked whether the beam is able to carry the shear. Yes, it is able to carry the shear. And also we have seen what is the actual strength of the web, whether it is a case of low shear or whether it is a case of high shear. But in this case, it is a case of low shear. Low shear means the shear buckling of the web is not going to happen, means the web is really, really available for the moment carrying capacity. So whatever the formula we have used for calculating the design moment, so that formula is also safe from the point of moment, safe from the point of shear, of course safe from the point of deflection, and also it is safe from the point of two types of buckling. One is the vertical buckling of the web, and another is the crimpling associated with the junction. So with this, students, I come to the end of the problem number one. So in fact, this is a major problem, and of course, so this is what the typical type of problem the student need to prepare from the point of examination. So let us see one more problem in the next class, where we will be designing the beam, and at the same time, we will be suggesting suitable cover plates. I will stop at this stage and wish you all the best. So if you have any questions, you can ask. Thank you very much.